It is Science Week, and our next guests are three science enthusiasts who are touring the country at the moment with a show all about baking in space. It combines science, baking and engineering. Baconeering.
Baconeering.
Baconeering. Yes, we have Dr. Niamh Shaw back with us. We have Andrew Smith. We also have Romain Charles. Guys, you're all very, very welcome to the show. Great
thank
to have you back on the
yeah,
show. You're welcome.
Thank you very much. It's lovely to be back.
The last time you were telling us about your love and your ambition to get out there.
It's out still into the same. The great unknown.
So,
yes.
Have you come any closer?
Well, yeah, I'm walking slowly towards space. Yeah. That's what I say, Daithí. Yeah, I mean, my work is really in communicating space and working as an artist and as an engineer. So, all of my work is about creating events like Baking in Space. And I feel like I've got to earn the right to be able to go up there. So, it's about taking what I do and going as far across the world as I can and gathering people so that I one day go up there.
So what steps have you taken so far?
Well, we were the last time I was here, I was on my simulated Mars mission, and that was in 2017, and then I've been involved in a zero gravity flight.
Is that your vomit comet?
The vomit comet.
Okay.
The very
why do you
one?
Call it the vomit? Oh my God! What actually happened there?
Well, what happens is that it's the manoeuvre off the plane, and so you get about 20 seconds where you're actually in free fall, and when that happens, you get to simulate what it's like to live as if you were on the International Space Station in microgravity. Yeah, it's quite intense.
How long could you last like that?
Well, you got 20 to 30 seconds at a time, but in order to get up there, the reason it's called the vomit comet is that you go up at a vertical and down at a vertical, and when that happens, you feel twice the force of gravity on your body, hence the vomit comet.
No, tell us about the show itself, Baking in Space.
Baking in Space is a show that myself and Andrew have put together in partnership with British Council, and it's about genuinely finding the science in the everyday. Everybody eats. Everybody knows how much fun it is to bake. So we know that there's science behind that and curiosity. We're always looking for methods to bring science to the general public and make them see that science is everywhere.
Because I suppose when people think of space jargon and terminology, people say, actually, I don't really know what that means. But when it's broken down, it's fairly straightforward.
It's very straightforward and it makes total sense. And people have to eat in space. So it's actually quite difficult. So it's really interesting how engineers and scientists have figured that out. So that's what the show's about and loads of great demonstrations.
And tell me about the response to the show then.
Well, it's been fantastic. We're sold out. So we've two shows in Dublin, and then yesterday we were in Galway, and then tonight we're in Cork. But this is the third time we've done it. We did it in Edinburgh Science Festival last year during Science Week, and again here this week. So we've
Andrew here as well.
There he is.
People will know this guy, won't they?
Yes,
from the Bake Off. But you have a few strings to your bow, don't you?
Yes. So I'm an aerospace engineer 4 days a week. I do a little bit of baking on the side, some engineering cake commissions, and then love putting shows together as well. So worked with Niamh, and really combining my two passions, baking and engineering, is what I love to do.
Because people say, hang on, baking and outer space, hang on a second, are they really supposed to come together? Because we're not talking about eating here, are we?
No. Well, so they do sound a little bit different, don't they? So what I'm not doing is making a cake in the shape of a rocket.
No.
What I'm using is the actual baking and the processes to explain the incredible engineering that keeps astronauts safe in orbit. So it's a direct explanation and it gets people thinking in a slightly different way.
Well, see, the thing about what I really, really like about it, we can all relate to it. Because this is very, very visual, and all of a sudden, if you put it just in a different context, it works like that as well, and that's why that works here at home, and this is why this works up in space.
Exactly, and we give people the recipes as well, so they can go home and, you know, what's better than an edible demo, right?
So
edible engineering.
You get to eat the props.
Exactly. So that's what everybody loves, and everybody who comes to our shows gets a little individual edible as well.
I had a lovely crunchy there before I came over, just to kind of prep myself for this, but tell us what's happening here.
Well, we're going to make a really large crunchy, and what I'm doing is I'm making a honeycomb. And the base of a honeycomb, all I've got in here is just golden syrup and caster sugar. And I've melted that down, and you're probably starting to get some nice
really
caramel wafts. So that's completely melted. It's got a nice auburn colour. I'm going to take that off the heat, and this is sodium bicarbonate. If you've ever made scones or soda bread, that's what goes in there. And when I add this, and I whisk it quickly, it releases a lot of carbon dioxide.
It changes colour as well.
It changes colour. It starts to rapidly inflate.
Whoa.
And you'll notice, if I put it there, it starts to grow
It's like expanding
quickly.
Foam.
It is like expanding foam, a little bit more tasty.
And edible.
So you do a bit like expanding foam, got to make sure you've got something that's big enough to take
to
it.
Hold
so
it.
That will completely inflate up, and because I don't want to wait for that one to set,
okay.
I've got the world's largest crunchy bar.
Crunchy without the
here.
Chocolate.
And what we use this to show is this is actually a direct explanation for how we protect astronauts on the space station.
Okay, in the space station itself?
Yes, so in, well, we don't use honeycomb, but we use the idea of the air gaps.
Yes.
Because space junk or little micrometeorites, 17,000 miles an hour, they could be travelling at. So
obviously
we've got to protect
them. You need something that's got to stop this or deflect it.
Exactly. So this is my projectile.
Okay, what's this?
This is my, so you can take that and you can drop it from a height. This is our space station wall, and hopefully it shouldn't break. it should absorb the impact. So you can actually throw it at it if you want. Okay. You can throw it. It goes through, but the whole structure...
The whole thing stays together.
Stays together, which is important, whereas if we just made it from caramel, it would have shattered. And it's the same idea of having those gaps that protects astronauts.
We can actually see pictures of the space station here. And so there we have. So this is what we're talking about, isn't it?
Yeah, and it's getting increasingly crowded up there as we launch more satellites, and especially if they crash into other satellites, we get more and more of these pieces, so it's becoming increasingly important to protect against that.
Now, tell us about this then. What's this?
So this is very exciting. This is from the Buran, which was the Russian version of the space shuttle. So this is a real piece of space hardware. This hasn't been to orbit. It did a flight test, but the idea is that this is a thermal protection system. So when you're coming back in to the atmosphere, things get very hot, by 1600 degrees C. Well, we don't want it to burn up. That's the key. Burning up is the thing, but that's the same in the movies. Exactly. So this is actually a tile, and this would be covering the entire base of the Buran as it came back in. And I've got a little blowtorch here.
So what is this made of?
This is made out of silicate, so very similar to the sand you'd find on the beach. Yeah. But we make it into fibres, and we make it in such a way that it's about 95% air, so it's got loads of air gaps. And when I torch that, you can see it's starting to glow.
Yeah.
Centre of that is about 1,000 degrees.
1,000?
The key thing is that spot doesn't move. So I could torch this entire tile for about 10 minutes, and you'd be able to lift it from the bottom. And that's what keeps our astronauts safe on re-entry. And it's exactly the same way that a meringue works.
Yeah.
When you whisk all those air bubbles into a meringue in a baked Alaska, and you torch the outside, it's the air bubbles that insulate the precious cargo on the inside.
So that's how come the ice cream is still...
Exactly. So whether it's ice cream or astronauts, little air gaps are very good at insulating.
It's the same thing.
Exactly the same thing.
Andrew, thank you very much. Rowan, great to have you, sir.
Thank you.
I believe you lived in a confined space with five other fellas for over 500 days.
That's correct.
A very special space. Tell us about the space.
So I simulated a return trip to Mars, and I spent 520 days with a crew of six, so I was with five other guys. Mm-hmm. And it was a scientific experiment trying to answer to one big question. Mm-hmm. Is man psychologically and physiologically able to endure the confinement of a trip to Mars? So in other words, are we able to live for 1.5 years with five other guys without killing each other and making sure that we still work efficiently together?
So are there still six?
Yeah, that's...
So that's a good start.
That's a success. We're six when we entered, we're still six when we visited.
So physically you were six, but mentally, what was it like?
Well, it was overall okay. We had all ups and downs, but luckily, it was not at the same time. So as a crew, we could help each other and go through the whole period.
I suppose just for people at home, how big was the space that you were in?
So you have to imagine three big cylinders. The biggest one was a storage module. Mm. The living one, the most important for us, had roughly the size of a bus. And inside this bus...
So six inside of a bus?
Yeah.
So that was your living space?
That was a living space with six rooms, one control room, one bathroom, one kitchen, and one living room.
Oh, my God.
For a year and a half.
Yeah, and you were okay?
And we're okay. Yeah. Well, we were volunteers.
Of course, food nutrition is very, very important when you're in space.
Definitely. Yeah, we learned that the hard way over there. But.
So tell us, what have we got here?
So here we have some space food. So some real space food. The normal food that the astronauts eat is here. So this is homestyle potato, so it's mashed potatoes.
This is your mashed potato?
And this is
so it doesn't fly away?
Exactly. So when you are eating and you want to drink, you just put it on the wall with the Velcro and it stays there. And
do you mix it with water or anything?
No, this one you just need to warm it.
To warm it.
Okay. Those ones you can just eat it. It's just a cracker.
Okay, that's just a cracker. So what?
This is bonus food. So it's
okay. Which means bonus food? Explain bonus food.
Bonus food means that it's... all that is very balanced. Bonus food, it can be a bit more sweet. It's okay. Yeah. It's a psychological support.
So it's a treat.
It's a treat, exactly.
Okay,
it's a treat.
Okay, when you're out in space, right, and when you're eating all this plain stuff, and when you eat the fancy stuff, how does that affect the whole environment, if you know what I mean?
Well, that goes well down. When we eat in space, actually the body is quite remarkable. It adapts, and you can easily eat without any problem in space.
Mm-hmm. Okay, okay. And what have we here then?
So this is bonus food. This is actually tiramisu.
More bonus food.
Yeah, it is.
Do you eat any regular food?
Well, it's more shiny, and because of my work, I had to test those ones.
This is tiramisu.
Yeah, it's dehydrated tiramisu.
Yeah. So, but again, I'd imagine psychologically, getting a bonus treat like this would kind of lift your spirits as well.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And so for this one, you need to add water, and this is what you have
here. So you put water in here and you mix it, and that's how you eat it.
And you wait for the tiramisu to rehydrate.
We have
So this is an example of what you have in space. So dehydrated food, like those strawberries, would be inside a package like that. Mm-hmm. You plug it here, a needle puts water, and then you wait for the strawberries to be rehydrated, and you just eat them as normal food.
Yeah. What happens if there's crumbs flying around the place?
Exactly. So crumbs, you don't want crumbs.
Why?
Because they are like debris. They are floating around. They are not falling on the ground like on Earth. You know, you just use a sweep and that's it. In space, they can go in the eyes of the astronaut, and it can be a health issue. So we try to avoid that at all.
And it's fair to say as well that this bread and butter, bread pudding with plums, mind you, was made by a Michelin-starred chef.
Mm-hmm.
My God.
Well, actually, this one.
Oh, sorry, this one. This obviously the smaller one. What was I thinking? That had to give you a big portion.
This creamy coffee was made by a three-star chef.
Romain, thank you very much. It's great to have you. Andrew and Niamh, great to have you again. And come back to us again. Hopefully, you will be a step closer again.
Always.
You have an event here in Cork tonight, I'm afraid.
That's right, in
half seven in Kino, but it is sold out.
It is, unfortunately,
Well done, lads. Thanks for coming. Great to have you. No more.